Good morning, Christ United Methodist Church. Good morning if you are with us live. Good morning if you are streaming or watching us on cable. Today is November 1st. It is All Saints Day. Today is a day that we want to take a moment during the worship service and remember those who have finished their course of faith and have headed to glory before us. We are going to be naming 32 individuals who are connected with our congregation or whose funeral Sam and I have helped out with. And let me just give you a brief word of instruction. I'll try to remember to remind you of this when we begin that part of the service. It'll come just after the message. And we would invite you, wherever you are, if that person has had an impact on your life, to stand as Sam places a stone from the bowl on the altar. After the service, you're invited to come up. There are baskets of stones on the kneelers, and take one. You may also take the one off the altar if you would like, but if you need extras for your family, don't hesitate to take one home with you to remember your loved ones, all right? Let's begin this morning with a word of prayer as we ask God to make us aware of his presence. Lord, what a cool, crisp morning. What a beautiful night. What a great day because you are among us. Father, it does not matter what the weather is. Every day is a great day because you are with us. And we pray this morning, Lord, that your presence would be just so obvious to us, that it would bring comfort and hope and healing to our hearts. Now, Father, give us courage and strength that we may worship you with all that we have. We ask this in the name of the Christ, and all God's people said, amen. Welcome to worship. Welcome, Pastor Sam.
Welcome. Welcome to everybody. Today we worship a holy God, amen. A God that is with us, and we light the candles to remind us of God's presence already here, but desiring so much to manifest himself among us. Scripture says the angels cry out, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." That's from Isaiah 6. In another passage, we see them raising their voices to exclaim, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing." We see that from Revelation. Let us stand and let us give honor and glory to the holy God today, who is above but with us all.
Holy. Thank you.
let us join our hearts and our voices as we all pray as one. Heavenly Father, we gather today as your people, and we are grateful that you have claimed us as your own. You have set us in the company of saints past and present, among those who have made bold witnesses to your goodness and your truth. We worship you as the hope of all who trust in you, knowing that in Christ you weep with those who mourn, even as you cry out in triumph over the grave. Unbind us from sin, release us from captivity, and with Lazarus, raise us from death to life, so that we may join that great crowd of saints who forever sing praise to your holy name. Through Christ, the resurrection and the life. Amen. He is Lord, he is Lord, he is risen from the dead, and he is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ may be seated.
Are there children who would like to come up front for the children's sermon?
Come on, Easton.
I'm glad you don't have your ghost costume on so I don't have to be afraid. Is that picture you up there? No. Oh, yeah. That's Mama, okay. So, you like my hat? Yeah. So, this hat, Easton, I got a long time ago, and it reminds me of a couple of things. It reminds me, first of all, of my friend who forgot this hat in my car and said I could keep it. And it reminds me of going to Promise Keeper events in Pittsburgh and how important they were to me. So, my hat is something that reminds me. Now, last night, you went out, and you went trick-or-treating, huh? Do you have candy at home?
Yep.
Does it remind you of all the fun you had?
Yeah.
Yes. Today, we're going to talk about remembering and how important that is. So this morning, I want you to remember all the fun you had last night and remember all the things you learned at Sunday school about how much God loves you, okay? All right, let's pray. Thank you, Lord, that you remind us through objects like hats, through things like candy, of all the fun we've had. And thank you for reminding us of the people who are so important in our lives, who have gone on before us. In Jesus' name, amen. How about a lollipop? A blue one? Very good. See you later, buddy. I figured out that the microphone works better if it's outside my mask, but it doesn't work better when I take my mask off, okay? A couple of names we want you to be remembering in prayer and a couple of situations. First, this morning is a difficult time for many of us as we remember people who are no longer with us. It causes us to pause and not just remember who they are, but it remembers how much we miss them. So I would ask you to be praying for families this morning as we take moments and remember. Please continue to remember Delaney, the young girl who was in the auto accident in Columbus. Please continue to remember Kevin Billingsley as he is home. And if you would, say a word of thanks to God. We had a trunk or treat event last night that exploded with children, literally. We were there for 2 hours, and if we didn't see 600 children, I'll eat my hat. It was insane how many children came through, and they just had a ball, A neat way for us to connect with the kids of the community and remind them that they're cared about. Let's pray. Father God, it is so easy to get stuck where we are, stuck remembering and forget to come back to right now, stuck fretting and worrying about tomorrow, and forgetting that you are already there, but you want us to live in the right now. We get stuck, Father, and we need your grace. We need your grace to overcome sin and temptation. We need your grace to move on, Lord, even when we remember and our heart aches for those we have lost. Father, on this day, we pray that you would give us an extra measure of grace to move forward. Not to run ahead of you, not to pretend that the people we have lost didn't matter, but Father, to remember and to move forward in the strength of what they have given us. This morning, Father, we also hold up those who are struggling with their health. For people like Delaney, who are struggling to recover, and it's been such a long road, we ask your grace. For people like Kevin and others who are dealing with life-limiting situations, Father, we pray that you would not only surround those patients with your care, but you would give their families incredible strength as they care for and watch over their loved ones, provide for them. Lord, you've been so gracious to this congregation. You've given us children, and you've given us an opportunity to influence children who have never even walked in these doors. What a joy it is, Lord, to share love around the community and to remind children that they are special, they are valuable, they are precious. Lord, may we continue to pour into them every opportunity we get, whether it's as a church family or on an individual basis. May we celebrate children every day, that they may grow up and come to know you and help transform this world for your kingdom. Now, Father, as we continue to worship, we just pray, Lord, that you would draw us into your very presence. And in your presence, Father, bring healing and wholeness, hope, and peace. We ask all of this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, and we pray the prayer that he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Bye.
Thank you, Pastor Sam. Good morning again, church. I hope you are making a habit during these COVID days when you attend worship to bring your Bible with you so that you can follow along in Scripture and perhaps even make notes if you would like in your text of something that God maybe shares with you or touches you in a special way so that down the road you can come back to those texts. And again, remember what God is teaching you and how He is touching you. This morning we want to go to 1 Thessalonians, the 4th chapter, reading verses 13 and 14. Here's what God's word says. Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again. And so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in Him. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Well, we've been, the last, 8 weeks or so, we were spending time on spiritual disciplines. And today we wrapped it up last week. So today we want to do a one-part series. How's that? We want to talk about what it means to be grateful in hope. What is all this gratitude and hope about? Folks, it's a day that we honor those who have finished their race of faith, those who have gone on before us. And let me be honest with you, we're going to name the people who have passed in the last year. And I don't know about you, but I wish we had time to read the names of everybody who has died in the last 5 or 10 years. For a year is not enough time. It's just not. And for some of you, it's only been a few weeks or a few months since you've had a loss. These are days that are difficult because we remember and our heart hurts. One of the names read today is going to be my nephew's name. He was in his 30s, died of a drug overdose. As much as that hurts, it's just as real the memory I have of laying my mom to rest in 1986. It's as real today as it was the end of 86 when we remembered her. So I know that for many of you, the weight of the loss is very real. I don't want to belittle that in any way, shape, or form. But I want us to take a few moments and look at Scripture and talk about those that have impacted our lives and what God's Word says about it. You see, Scripture reminds us that we are not to grieve as those who have no hope. Let's be clear. Scripture does not say, don't grieve. It's not what it says. People take this to mean that if followers of Christ show any sadness at the time of a death, that somehow they don't have faith. It's not it at all. It's about the loss that we experience. And that is why it is hard. God's promised us that one day we're all going to stand before Him. We're all going to stand before the throne of grace and see the Lord, which means there is clearly another world, one unseen to you and I, that exists, and we are not aware of what all goes on there. Scripture gives us a few hints, but for whatever reason, God has not seen it necessary to give us vast detail about what that's going to be like. And so there's a lot of questions, there's a lot of mystery about what's going to happen between the moment we close our eyes here and the moment we open our eyes there. I wish I had great detail to share with you, but I don't. God's not given us that. But what He has given us is plenty of reasons on this side of eternity to grieve but yet be okay. Let's remember, people who have no hope, people who do not have Christ, are stuck, aren't they? For them, the future is a vast unknown. And for them, there is nothing to celebrate. There are many inscriptions found from the time of Christ in the Roman world of people who were not followers of Christ, and they are sad epitaphs. They talk about there being nothing on the other side. And the only hope they have is the comfort they can be to one another in such tragic loss. And then there are the words of the faithful in the catacombs, often misspelled, crudely worded, but words of incredible hope, because they know that one day there will be a great reunion. A great reunion. And unlike our family reunions, we won't have to deal with sin, which means there won't be any aunts, uncles, or cousins that annoy you. Oh, they'll be there, but they won't be annoying. What a glorious reunion that will be, won't it? The potato salad won't go south after 2 hours out in the sun. Nobody will say something that rubs you the wrong way. We'll be together, and it will be glorious. And that is part of the hope that helps us to survive. Our hope is inspired by those who impact our lives, and our hope is inspired by the promises of God's word. So let me walk you through these two aspects of hope as we remember. Those who have inspired us. I don't know who's on your list, but I've made a list of seven names that span in my life a lot of years. They're names of people, not family members, but people who have touched me in amazing ways. People like Betty Shakley, who taught me that God was near. People like Warren Benson, who poured energy into me as a young seminarian and let me know I was valuable to him. People like Ed Ellig, who when I got to my first church had already been lay leader for 39 years and taught me what it was to have a lifelong faithful commitment to Christ. People like Don Ludwick, a very reserved, very quiet dairy farmer who had lived through a variety of tragedy in his life and in a very calm, certain way followed Christ and made others aware of who Christ was. People like Chris Hampton, who at 35 years of age lost her battle with cancer, but gave me an incredible image of what it meant to die with grace and dignity and faith. People like Dick and Cushy Dickert, who died only 6 months apart and a year before we would have never dreamed that they'd be gone so quickly. But they showed my family incredible love and patience and generosity. People like Thelma Mitchell, who her faith gave her the ability to laugh at the silliest things, even though her life was a life of difficulty and tragedy. Who's on your list? What names go through your head when you think about people who have impacted you? Maybe as a small child, maybe as an adolescent, maybe as a young adult or a young parent. Maybe as a new grandparent. Some of them may have been old and full of years. Some of them may have been so young their life had only begun. Who are the ones who have impacted our lives and yet give us incredible hope? Can we form a blessing and say, thank you, Lord? Thank you, Lord, for those lives. Some of them ending way too quickly. Some of them, Lord, we would love to have seen what would happen had they grown full of years. Lord, we can only imagine what their life would have been like. Do I need to say it? God did not take them to punish you in any way, shape, or form. God did not decide he needed another angel in heaven, so he took them. That's not what Scripture teaches, folks. Death is never a punishment, ever. Christ took care of that on the cross. We do not need to believe that somehow we did something wrong so God took our loved one. No. That's never the case. Death is a part of living life in a fallen world. Death is always the enemy. Even though I have seen on occasion where God has allowed death to come as a welcome relief to pain and suffering, it is still something that we were never intended to have to deal with. So not only does our hope come from those who have impacted our lives, but our hope also comes from the promises in His Word. Do you notice in this text that death, when it comes to us, is spoken of as sleep? Now, parents of little ones, let me just say this. Don't use that word to talk to your children about the death of a family member. They won't go to sleep the next night. It's never a good idea. But as adults, I think we need to get our head around this. In this text, it says that Christ died, but it talks about how we sleep. You see, what Paul is trying to say is that Jesus Christ experienced death for all of us and took on the punishment so that we don't die. Physically, do we transition to eternal life? Yes. Is there eternal death for you and I? Never. We sleep until we rise with Christ on the other side. Let that soak in a minute. I still remember sitting with Mary Harbaugh, a lady who was fairly full of years, but still too young to die. Aren't they always? Mary had only been diagnosed with cancer 5 months before, and I still remember sitting by her bed one day and saying to Mary, Mary, I think you know that your time is really, really, really short. She acknowledged that she did, and I said, it's likely, Mary, that in the next 24 hours, you're going to be standing before the throne of grace. And she smiled. Her eyes may have closed on this side, but they certainly opened on the other. And that's what God's Word teaches us. That we transition from here to there. And what is there like? Well, again, Scripture hasn't made it abundantly clear. There's some images in Revelation and other places in Scripture. The passage that I love is out of Ephesians 3. It says this, now to Him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to His power, that is at work in us. To Him be glory. I got a pretty big imagination. I don't know about you. But I only know what I've seen. And I can only imagine things that I have seen. What's glory going to be like? Oh my. The Word says it's going to be magnificent. The Word of God says that we are going to stand before our Creator and there will be no shame, there will be no suffering, there will be no crying, there will be no death. Man, I can't wait. in the two verses after where we stopped reading, it says that Christ is going to come back with a trumpet and a call from God. And all those who have died before, their bodies are going to physically rise. We're going to get caught up with them if we're still alive. And together, we're going to zip through the clouds. Maybe that's why many of us dream about flying without aid of an airplane. Amen? Maybe it's a piece that God has put in us to remind us that one day that's going to be reality. I can't wait. To be gathered up with all the saints. To see Ed and Warren and Chris and Dick and Cushy. To see Thelma and Betty and Anna Marie, my mom. To see my grandma and my grandpaps. God's word makes it clear that there are promises that we can stand on. You see, our grief is not about what happens to those who go before us. Our grief is about our separation from them. And that is why I still find myself at nearly every funeral crying. I must confess, it happens a lot more the older I get. What's up with that? When I was younger, I could do a funeral dry-eyed with the best of them. Doesn't happen so much anymore, does it? I think the older you are, the more you're aware that there are too many people that you know that have made that transition. And all those names, all those faces rush back through every time. The people that you're going to gather with before the throne and sing praise to God. And that reality settles in. That's why we gather and grieve. Those who have died in Christ need nothing. They are whole. For the first time in their life, they are whole. No sin, no pain, no struggle. Boy, I can only imagine their experience. And I'm sure I fall short. Folks, this day, we want to remember with gratitude the hope that God pours into us. The hope that we experience through others who have gone on before and have poured into our lives. And the hope that His Word pours into us. That one day, we'll gather before the throne. We won't have to worry about 6 feet or a mask or how loud we sing. Amen? Or how we sound when we sing. There will be music that we can't imagine. There will be singing that is glorious, even if you don't like singing. Oh, what a day that'll be. Until that moment, we still struggle. But because that moment's there on the horizon, we have hope. And that hope is what gets us through. Let's pray. Father God, it is so difficult to walk this journey of faith. Father, we want details that we don't have. We have loss, Lord, that is just painful. And yet we are striving, Father, to have hope. So this day, Father, remind us of your presence. Your presence that was there at our conception. Your presence that has walked there every moment of our lives. Your presence that carried us through in those tragic times when we lost our loved ones. Your presence that will see us through not just today, but every tomorrow, until we behold your presence with our own eyes in the glory that is your presence. May we stand tall with that hope. and may it give us courage. We ask this in the name of the Christ. Amen. And Pastor Sam is going to prepare to move rocks from our bowl to our altar. As I prepare to read these 32 names, and I would remind you, please, if one of these names is a relative or someone who has impacted you, just stand where you are and honor that name. Let us begin. The first name we share is Lester Dean Hoffman. Mary Ann Dietrich. Sandra Rice. Eugene McWilliams. William Ledbetter. Marvis Hoover. Jeffrey Fry. Mark Wagner. Kathy Baker. Joyce Lockhart. Let me just remind you, you're welcome to stand where you are if you want to honor one of these names. Janice Rolette. Esther Miller. Dwayne Greenlee. James Moon. Harold Jones. Janet Gamble. Sorry. Martha Pyle. Richard Rich Fagley. Norma Aiken. Beverly Bevy Kramer. Harold Hal Beazel. Dale Grimm. David Corson. Lester Cutchall. David Cutchall. Anita Jeannie Cutchall. Pamela Jean Hoover. And John Hoover. Charles Chuck Schweitzer. Georgia Ann Boffman. Robert Boffman. And lastly, Karen Hughes. Father God, it's not just these that we remember, but all who've gone on before us. Names and memories, Father, are flooding our minds. Thank you, Father. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for walking with us and giving us these individuals to impact our lives this year. We pray, Lord, that you would give us the grace we need for this day and for every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let us stand and let us celebrate with the saints above. Be seated. We continue our worship with a time of offering our gifts to the Lord, and this morning, once again, we have been reminded of how much we have to be thankful for the gifts of lives and loved ones that God has blessed us with. So let us be thankful today as we offer our gifts to Him. There are offering plates in the narthex for those seated here in this place, and those watching online, please stay with us for a moment, and a slide will be available to give you instructions on how you may give. Thank you to all who have supported the ministry of Christ Church in these recent months. Let us pray. Oh God, we ask that you would bless each gift today, oh Lord. For God, they come with a heart of thanks to you. You have blessed us, you have given us so much, and we remember those that you have placed in our lives that have been a light to guide us to where we are today. So, Father, we come in humble adoration and fond remembrance. So bless these gifts, we pray, in the name of Jesus Christ, the risen Lord. Amen. The timeless theme, earth and heaven will pass away. It's not a dream, God will make all things new that day. Gone is the curse from which I've stumbled and fell.
only sound is the praises to Christ our King. Slowly the names from the book are read. I know the King, so there's no
word of instruction before I let you go. If you haven't noticed, the whole front entrance of the church is all tore up. We can't use those doors at all. So when you exit the sanctuary, we're going to ask you to walk through Heritage Hall to get to the back door so that you don't run into people coming in via the hall. I pray today that you would remember, not because I want you to be in pain, because I want you to heal. Remember the love, remember the care, but most importantly, remember the grace of God that goes with you every moment of every day. For it's in the name of Jesus we ask all these things. Amen and amen. Go in peace.